I am Brad Keelor. He is Kyle Rollins. Next up on Director's Cut, find out how he feels about being selected as the seed lecturer this year, and maybe you'll get a hairy seed story too. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every single week, I sit down with a different GI member who has stories to tell. Some of them are personal, some are professional, but all of them, every single week, are fun. If you don't know anything about the Geo-Institute, after you spend some time watching this today and getting to know Kyle, you should head over to geoinstitute.org. And there you will find out, I mean, I could list all the things, but it's a lot of things that you will find out. So I will just tell you that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists, and that we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. And if you like what you see today, and viewers, I always feel strongly that you will, you should click like, subscribe, and get notifications, and we will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. Now on to our guest. Joining us from Brigham Young University, where he is a faculty member in the Civil and Construction Engineering Department. He is also, there's a couple of things here, the 2023-24 Geo-Institute Cross USA Lecturer and the 2024 H. Bolton Seed Award winner and lecturer. It is Kyle Rollins. Kyle, welcome.
Good to be with you, Brad. Thanks for having me on.
We are going to have a good time today. We have 10 questions the same way that we do every week, and two of them are the same ones that we ask everybody. And we start with one of those. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Okay. Well, I'm a professor of geotechnical engineering, so my main job is to help the students to learn the basic concepts and analysis methods in geotechnical engineering. And then once they've got that understanding, I work with these students to, in an effort to discover new knowledge that can benefit our profession and drive our learning forward. And it's, for me, we've done that primarily from large-scale field testing. I've had that luxury of doing that. And one of the big things that are interesting about that is you get to see results for the first time ever about how things behave in the real world. And sometimes you're surprised and you go, can that be right? And maybe our equipment's not working right. And then you satisfy yourself if that's the case. And sometimes it confirms what you already know. But many times you are surprised by what you're seeing, and you then have to figure out how the world works. So I really love the discovery process, working with students to explain what we're seeing. It just keeps me going every day of that process. I had a PhD student that worked with me, and we had done, we were looking at PY curves for laterally loaded piles in liquefied soil. So we got these test results from the field, and he came back and he said, okay, I've got the PY curves developed for us for the liquefied sand, but something must be wrong because they're concave up. And I know all PY curves are concave down. And I know it should be like that. It should be like that because the soil's dilating. So this discovery process with me and the students is just a wonderful thing.
Well, that's a great answer. And I mean, I got to tell you, you can really see the joy coming through, especially with that last story. And I think that's what we should have in all of our faculty members, especially when you think about what it's like when you're 18 years old and you walk into that classroom for the first time, or when you're a grad student for the first time and you walk in, you really need that enthusiasm in order to get you through. So that was a really good answer. I liked that. If you are eagle-eyed, our viewers out there, and I think most of our viewers are, they will realize it is January. And if you've been to the gym this month, there's probably a lot more people there than there would be normally. we have to talk about New Year's resolutions. I've never really made any in my life, and I thought about that as I wrote this question. Kyle, do you have any memorable New Year's resolutions?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm like most people. I make some resolutions, and I'm not always that great about keeping them. But about 10 years ago, I was running with my brother on a little vacation, and I realized that he was 5 years older than me, but I couldn't keep up with him. He was in much better shape, and he said, Kyle, you need to start running, not only to improve your cardio, but to relieve stress. He says, I can't believe you haven't done this already. So I went home and I started a running program. So I got up to maybe 3 or 4 miles 3 times a week, and not huge, but enough that it was improving me. So I've been able to keep at that for maybe 10 years or so. I went into the doctor a little while ago, and the doctor was listening to my heart and my lungs, and he goes, are you an athlete? And I said, no, I'm not an athlete. He goes, well, you have the heart and the lungs of an athlete. So I thought, maybe it's paying off. So about 5 years ago, I decided to do a 10K run at down in Charleston. We had worked on the Cooper River Bridge on the foundation load testing down there prior to doing that, building that bridge. And now they have the Cooper River Run where they have it's like 10,000 people run across from Mount Pleasant to Charleston, and they go over this big bridge that we'd worked on. So it was a few years ago. It was going to take place on April 2nd. So my wife and I went down there, and we got in, and I finished in the top 10% for my age bracket. Whoa. And that made me feel really good. Of course, I'd signed up for the 70 to 80 year old category, so maybe that explains that. Not really.
Had you ever been a runner before this? Like, ever?
No. In high school, I was a swimmer, and I was on the swim team, so I had pretty good lungs, but I wasn't. Some people have told me that I have the physique of a long distance runner, but I've never done anything in school or anything.
I would have to agree. My son does cross country, and he's about 6 feet tall and 135 pounds. And yeah. He walks in the room and people say, oh, that's a cross country runner right there. But that's incredible that you got started later on like that. I mean, what were you thinking the first couple of times you went out? Because a lot of people who don't run for a reason, because they just don't find it enjoyable. How long did it take you before you thought it was fun?
Well, almost every time I run the first mile, it's my body's going, why are you doing this? You can stop. Just give up right now. But after you get through that mile, your body kind of gets conditioned to it. I've heard that you get some endorphins coming through your system, and you feel like, I'm into this now. I can do it, you know. So it helps to get to that second mile somewhere along the line.
And I agree. And the opposite is true too. You don't want to feel too good at the beginning, because guaranteed by like mile 3 or 4, you're going to be like, I don't know what I was thinking. This is the worst run I've had like this year. It's miserable. We've all been there before. Oh, that's good though. Well, congratulations on doing that.
So this year,
go for it.
This year I don't have a big resolution, but I'm trying to enjoy the events of my life a little more and worry a little less. That I'm a worrier. And for the day before the week before the Vancouver Geo-Congress, we're planning to go up and ski Whistler. So I've never been there. We live in Utah, so we have plenty of ski resorts. But the Geo-Congress there now is going to give me an opportunity to ski Whistler. So we're looking forward to that.
I am going to predict that you will not be the only Geo-Congress attendee who's at Whistler during that week or the week after Geo-Congress.
Yeah, good opportunity.
That's going to be really good. We always have the research question third in the interview, and sometimes people just say a phrase or give a research topic, and I say, wow, yeah, there's absolutely no way we couldn't talk about anything else. One of my favorites, I think, is scour for our viewers who watch this a lot. We could have scour all day. Kyle, you're going to talk about blast liquefaction. Come on. How could this not be fun? I think, as a matter of fact, that's really all I have to say. Tell us what you've been working on.
Yeah. Well, about 20 years ago, when we were trying to figure out the behavior of piles in liquefied ground, we were looking for strategies. We could do it in a centrifuge. We could go to field sites where earthquakes had happened in the past and try and see what was going on. But we really wanted something that we could do at full scale in natural ground conditions. So I was thinking that we could maybe get some of those, like the T-Rex oil prospecting trucks, to come out and shake and try and liquefy the soil. And I called my friend Roman Ritsu at University of Michigan. See, you've got your Michigan sweatshirt on. And he said, no, Kyle, you shouldn't do that. You should try explosives. I go, oh, really? We could do that? And he goes, yeah, I think we tried a little for my PhD dissertation. I think it will work. So we found a spot to where we could do it. I'd worked at the U.S. Navy lab in Port Hueneme and had some Navy connections, and the Navy was closing down Treasure Island that they had occupied for, I don't know, since World War II. And it hadn't gone into the possession of the city of San Francisco yet. And they gave us permission to go test out there. And that, everybody knows that liquefaction had been a big problem on Treasure Island, because it's hydraulic fill. So we went out and experimented. We set off single charges. And the idea is that stress waves goes through, and it also creates some residual shear stresses that build the pore pressure up to 100%. So we found out with one charge detonating what it would take to cause liquefaction and the distance away that we could do it. Then we set off a whole series of charges, and we found out we could do it. My colleague here at Brigham Young, Les Yaud, had developed pore pressure sensors for monitoring pore pressures during liquefaction. So we used that same technique at Treasure Island. Then we did tests on single piles. We would liquefy the soil with explosives, and then with the actuator from my colleague at UC San Diego, Scott Ashford, we would rapidly load the piles in both directions and put on load deflections clear to 9 inches. And we found out that after it's liquefied, it took maybe 8 times more deflection to get the same resistance prior to liquefaction. So we were getting great results there. We did tests with pile groups. We did tests with different drilled shafts, 2 feet and 3 foot shafts. And we did an add-on where we looked at earthquake drains to see if they would function properly. And we found out we could do all kinds of things like this. South Carolina was having questions about building the Cooper River Bridge in Charleston, and they called Caltrans and said, what would you do to evaluate this? And they said, well, here in California, we do these full-scale blast liquefaction experiments. And so they invited us out to do those tests out in South Carolina in Charleston. Dan Brown was involved in writing the specifications, and Dan said, we can not only use those high-speed actuators, why don't we throw in the statnamic load sled, and we'll liquefy the soil, and then we'll fire off the statnamic, and it will create an equal and opposite force on the shaft. So these were 8.5 foot diameter drilled shafts that went something like 140 feet into the ground. And we're expecting liquefaction in the top 40 feet. So we would set off the charges. We'd watch the water come to the surface carrying sand grains for maybe 15 minutes. And then we'd count down the blast and the statnamic, and it would go sliding off. This is like a 100-ton sled, and it would go shooting off maybe 50 to 100 feet down the runway. So they used the results we got from that test to design the the bridge for lateral spread and liquefaction, and they increased the size of the shaft to 10 feet diameter. I've always wondered what the rationale was and the impact we had on that, but really, really a fun time for innovation in geotechnical engineering.
So you lived up to the hype. Blast liquefaction is in fact fun. I like that a lot. The two things I want to note there, the first one, Roman seems like such a peaceful individual. I can't believe he's the one who suggested the blast liquefaction to you. And then the second thing, it's not out yet, but everybody can look for an article actually on Treasure Island in the Geostrata that's coming out, the February-March issue, which is all about earthquake engineering. So you can check that out in a few weeks in your mailbox. We're going to talk a little bit about blast liquefaction later on in the interview. We have some other really important topics to get to. This is what Director's Cut is all about, and we'll get to one of those right now. Describe the best sandwich you have ever eaten.
My favorite sandwich is a pepper steak at the Italian Place restaurant in Orem, Utah, actually. It's really just south of... just north of Provo. And it's steak with a lot of good seasonings, garlic, onions, tomatoes, peppers, mixed in with provolone cheese on a deli bun. I found out that my DNA likes, from 23andMe says, you like salty food. Surprise, surprise. And so every couple of weeks, I get this craving that I've got to have one of the Italian Place sandwiches, and we go over there, my wife and I, and really enjoy that. I also like pulled pork sandwiches in the Carolinas. So there's a lot of great food out there to eat, for sure.
You've gone back in this interview to South Carolina three times already. So, I mean, anybody who's had, especially barbecue, right, in the Southeast, there's a different style in every state and sometimes even within the state. Do you have a particular one that you like, or are you just a fan of everything?
Yeah, I like most of them, but I like the style in the Carolinas, the barbecue. There's a restaurant out there called Sticky Fingers, and we really enjoy going to that place. Like a little more smoky taste, and but I think everybody has their personal preference about that, and it just is whatever they love, right?
And it'll keep you running, right? If you're going to have those sandwiches, you got to make sure you're burning those off. But that, I got to look up this pepper steak one too. That sounds pretty good. So as we mentioned at the top of the interview, you are the Cross USA lecturer this year. While this academic year, I guess, is really how it shakes out most of the time, 23-24. You're several months in at this point. You've done a bunch of lectures. You still have a long way to go, though. So that finish line is still way down there. So far, what has been the most fun about being the Cross USA lecturer?
Wow. There's lots of things that are fun about it, right? First, you get to share your research that you've done over your career with people across the country. And I love talking about what we've discovered from large-scale testing. Probably the funnest thing is just meeting new friends and seeing old friends as you go around the country. I run into former students and professor friends at university. We were at Seattle and saw Pedro Arduino and Steve Kramer and the others, and Bob up there. And, you know, in Seattle, I think we had the biggest group since COVID. So we felt pretty good about that. People getting all engaged again in person is really nice. Maybe another thing that's good is seeing the sites across the country and eating their specialty foods like we were talking about. When I was in Chicago earlier this year, I had an extra morning, so I went up the Sears Tower. I'd never been there. I show it in a lot of my lecture slides. And at the top, they've got these, maybe you've been there, these glass boxes that are hanging off the side and cantilevering off the edge. I think it's called the edge. And so I decided I would go try that out. And I Your thinking mind has to get past your primitive mind that says, don't go out there. But, you know, it can step out and then you're looking straight down through the glass about 1,400 feet down. And that was really fun.
Now, that one I know. So at the Hancock building, which I don't think is called that anymore either, they have one called 360 Chicago, where you go out in the little thing and there's a mechanism in there where you are moved, where it will lower you like this or off to the side. Is the one at the Willis Tower the same or is it static? You're just
in there. It's static. But you know, even the static ones can be pretty scary. We used to take student groups to China with us, and there was a little area like this that on one of the towers that had glass tiles. They're really thick and they're in a steel frame, but one of my colleagues found that there was one of these little tiles that had just a little glitch where the tile would drop down when you stepped on it. So yeah, he's a practical joker. He'd like lure these unsuspecting students, hey, come over here, and they would step on that tile and it drop down, you know, like you're 1,000 feet in the air, and man, their hearts just went out their chest for the surprise of that, man. So you got to be careful, huh?
That is hilarious, terrifying. Like, it's a lot of things all rolled up in one.
Maybe.
But I like that story. So like I said, you do still have a long way to go. And if everybody's looking forward to it, we will have the Cross USA lecturers on the YouTube channel over the summer. But Kyle still has a lot of stops to make throughout the year. So be sure to check GI social media, the GI website, and your local chapter's information as well for news on when Kyle might be coming to your neighborhood. The other question that we ask everybody when they come on Director's Cut is a little bit of a history one, a little nostalgia. How did you first get involved in ASCE and GI?
Well, I'm kind of an unusual guy because my father was a geotechnical professor at BYU before me. So growing up, there were always geotechnical journals on the coffee table and civil engineering magazines. So I grew up with ASCE. But when I was in college, I took civil engineering, of course, and I was a vice president in our student chapter at Brigham Young. And BYU has a very active student chapter. We have weekly meetings, service projects that are ongoing every year, major service projects like replacing a footbridge somewhere and designing and replacing it. And so we were always a finalist in the Ridgeway Awards for the best student chapter. And so that got me really enthused about geotechnical engineering and opportunities and the ability to help our communities through what we've learned in civil engineering. And then later on, of course, I started publishing and articles and got had great appreciation for the reviewers that go through all this, all these papers, and always improve your work. And then the copy editors that correct all the mistakes in it. No matter what you do, you have problems, and they get it published and out there. So that's how I got connected.
And you never had the urge to do something completely opposite. I mean, I think it happens to a lot of kids. It definitely happened with me. I saw my dad's job, and I thought, you know, that's actually not that interesting to me. And I don't know that I actively wanted to do something that was polar from that, but it helped. It probably pushed me to what I ended up doing in life. What was it like for you? Was there ever a moment where you didn't want to be a civil engineer?
For sure, there was. For most of my life growing up, I wanted to be an astronaut. Okay, so I followed the space program very carefully, and I found out later on that that was a little difficult to do, but I found out that you could apply to be a mission specialist. You didn't have to fly the shuttle, but you could still be on it. And I thought that would be great. So when the space shuttle blew up on launch, I was a PhD student at Cal Berkeley, and I said, you know what? This is a perfect time to apply because they'll get this all fixed up and make it even better than it was. And so I applied to the mission specialist program, and they wrote back to me and said, you can't be a mission specialist until you've actually completed your PhD. So, and you'd need it. It was a year later I graduated, but I got this offer at BYU, and everything seemed to fit in naturally, and so I came this way. Later on, I got called up by somebody from a Keller that was doing some work at Kennedy Space Center, and they had me design some foundations for the escape system for the astronauts. And I went down there to talk about some of the issues, and the guy said to me, would you like to go out to the pad? Would I? You bet. Take me. So he said, we walk out there, and the guy, the structural engineer, says, let me take the keys. I want to take him up on the launch tower. So we hopped in and go up on the elevator right up to where the astronauts, walk out and get in the launch vehicle. And that was a dream come true, right? To be up there on that control tower and see where the system would take the astronauts off to get them off quickly if there was a hydrogen leak or something like that.
That is incredible. Wow, that is a great story. This is why we do Director's Cut, because you get stuff like this. That's great. And I will say, for our viewers, for anybody who has not visited Kennedy Space Center, you're not going to do anything like what Kyle got to do. But just going there and going to the visitor center and going on the tour is absolutely amazing. You don't have to have any history with the space program, I think. I feel like you could not know anything about it and show up there and be a fan when you walk out at the end of the day. So, that was really good. Another, again, hard-hitting journalistic question here, but one that we've never asked, so I had to put it in your interview, Kyle. I was thinking about getting a new phone recently, and it made me think about my behavior when I get a new one, the things I do. And so I wanted to ask you, when you get a new phone, what's the first thing you download to it?
Well, I love music, and so that's got to be on there too. But I think the most critical app for me is like something like Google Maps or Waze. I put them both on. So I'm old enough to remember when remember those days when you just had a paper map, right? And they were terrible. And I've been lost in most of the major cities around the world from using paper maps. But when we one time we picked up a rental car in Lisbon, and we wanted to drive south to the Algarve coast at the bottom of the country. And we said, we need a map. And they said, we don't have one, but just follow the signs for the 24th of April bridge to the south and across the Tagus River, and you'll be okay. And we said, that's it. He goes, well, it won't worry. It won't matter much because you probably won't make it. You'll probably get lost and never get across the river. Anyway, so now with that map capability with Google Maps, you can go to Jerusalem and all those little weird places that have little teeny roads and you can get through. But I have found a problem with it. And we were in England and the Lake District in Northern England, and it routed us down this really, looked like a really teeny road. There must be a setting that I can get off on and keep on major roads, but I didn't want to go down there. And there was a guy walking out, and I said, will this get us to Hawkshead? And he goes, well, yeah, it would get you there, but I would never take a car on it. That would be crazy, right? So we've been down those little one-lane roads, it looks like, and there's a big big agricultural vehicle coming in with a lot of spikes and stuff on it. We thought, we're dead, So be careful about taking the fastest route. It may not be the best route.
we had a similar experience in Sequoia National Forest this summer. Found a road that, similar to you, I would probably never willingly drive on. We did not see that one through to its end. so that's good, though. I like that answer. So in many years as a professor, you've seen a lot of students, and I think you do it when you're a hiring manager in a company. You feel like you've just got this inherent skill where you look at someone and you can tell they'd be a good fit on the team, or they're going to be exceptional at something. So for you, Kyle, what can you see immediately that tells you that a student is special or has special abilities?
Well, there's a couple things I look at. I've supervised now something like 140 graduate students to completion. And when they sit down and I say, tell me about yourself, and they say, I was raised on a farm, I know that is going to be somebody that I would like to hire, because they know how to work. And they also know how to innovate and solve problems, because they are always having to fix things, I think. And usually it's not the conventional way. They have to make do with what they've got and get it fixed and operating. So they are really expert at duct tape and baling wire kind of approaches to fix things. And since I do a lot of field work, they're good to have. And I also really love students when I see that they are able to think independently. Right. So they may say, oh, I was looking at some research you did and I looked it up and I found out this and that about it. And because many times we don't know what the answer is going to be on a project, and we have to find it ourselves. And so I love those students that are willing to step out on their own and look for answers.
And now every single student that comes in to meet you is going to start out with that they grew up on a farm. And maybe it was a farm in the heart of Manhattan or Los Angeles.
Right.
You'll have to do a little more digging.
Yeah.
One thing that I wanted to put in here, another question that I haven't ever asked anybody on the show. So you drew the lucky straw here, Kyle. And I said we'd talk about blast liquefaction a little more later, and I think we're going to now. What's the most shocking thing that somebody said to you in your life, and what did you learn from it?
This has to be an experience we had in New Zealand. We were, again, working with the Earthquake Commission in New Zealand and Tonkin and Taylor over there to come up with the most efficient methods for mitigating liquefaction hazard. And so our job was to liquefy the underlying soil and see how the whole system would work, where they improved the upper like 3 or 4 meters of the soil with a variety of techniques. And so they could test the improvement with CPTs and other institute tests, or the T-Rex from Texas had down there, but they needed to look at the whole system response. So they let me have a little spot where I could put in some auger cast piles. There were 3 auger cast piles going down 15 meters or so, something like that. 2 feet in diameter and in a triangular pattern. And then to produce some weight on these things, a dead weight, we scrounged around and found we could put a little frame together, and we put 300 tons of crane mats and steel blanks and stuff stacked about 20 feet high. And as we were putting this on, we would have to shift the weights over from one pile to the other to try and get an idea of the load deflection behavior of these different piles. So there was a New Zealand crane operator, of course, that was managing the system. He kept going, "You crazy Americans, you're going to get us all killed." So we didn't think we were being that far out of line, but it was scary to me. And I was very worried the all weekend before the test blast that was coming up on Monday morning, that the whole thing was just going to tip over. And guess who showed up the day of the test blast? It was the crane operator. He was kind of hoping that it would all tip over and fall down, you know, but he wanted to see that, wanted to see us go wrong. But I was really worried because I knew that we had a factor of safety on one of the piles after liquefaction, we were estimating would be around 1.1. So it was, we were really close to the edge of failure. I told my wife I was really scared about this, and she said, well, what's the worst going to happen? It tips over, and that's the risk of doing cutting edge research, right? You might have a problem. So anyway, they set off all the explosive charges, and it tilted a little bit, but it stayed in place. So the New Zealanders that were working with me, they thought I was crazy to start with, but then they saw that, and suddenly I went from zero to hero in about 15 seconds of field test. They wanted to come study with me, and it was a complete change of heart among those guys. So I learned that don't always believe all the critics out there. You have to do your homework and develop your plan, and then have some confidence in yourself, and not worry too much when you're doing research on the cutting edge that you might have a failure here or there or some problem. That's the nature of the beast, right?
That's really good. Probably inspirational for anybody who needs or wants to take risks in the research that they do. So I really like that. We mentioned at the top, and again, we've announced it already, so unless people have been living in some kind of cave, they know that you are the 2024 seed lecturer, and you will be giving the seed lecture in Vancouver at Geo-Congress, and at this point, just a few weeks. Can you describe your emotions since your selection as seed lecturer? I mean, you were with Harry Seed in the 80s at Cal. This has to be very meaningful.
Yeah, this Jihan called me as his role as the president, Geo-Institute. And when I saw his name on the caller ID, I thought, oh, he's calling about a paper review or some proposal that he might want to be doing. And when he told me that I'd been selected as the seed award recipient, I about fell off my chair. I couldn't have been more shocked, actually. But this was, for me, such a great honor, and it means a great deal to me. I was one of the last three PhD students that seed supervised, and I'm just thrilled to be listed among all those past recipients that I respect so much. And like my faculty colleague here at BYU, Les Yaud, who received this award 20 years or so ago. So Harry Seed's one of my greatest heroes, and he was like a father to me. He took good care of me and my family while we were at Berkeley. And my father, Ralph Rollins, we already said he was a geotechnical engineer and professor, and I know he'd be very proud of me since he held seed in such high regard as well. When I was started at Berkeley, seed and my father were invited speakers at a symposium on dam design in Montana. And Harry had just hired me, and so he asked my father if he had any advice for him. And according to my dad, he said, you'll get a lot more out of Kyle if you encourage him and compliment him rather than criticize him and yell at him. So Seed said, oh, that's good to know. So I don't know if it was that or what it was, but he treated me very well. And I really loved the experience. But when I signed on with Seed, this seems really trivial at this time now, but computer graphics for representing what you're doing in finite element model was very primitive. And BYU had developed a program called Movie BYU, which would take all the finite element results and produce color contour drawings of everything. And you could link these all together and create a movie of what was going on. Sounds far-fetched, but we see it every day now, right? It's commonplace. And Seed's vision, what he was working on Aswan Dam, and he let me participate. And his vision was that we could tell the Egyptians that they could take an IBM PC, which had 10 megabytes storage capacity, and they could do everything that we were doing on a mainframe computer and solve their own problems. And so I would start the program up at 5 p.m. on the PC, and then I would come back around 9 a.m. the next morning, and it would just be finishing the work, right? So huge effort. Of course, this has all changed so much in the past that this might seem like a relic of history. But one of the great scares of my life was when I hit a wrong key on Seed's PC, and it said, starting the process of reformatting the hard drive. Thought, oh no, I'm going to be fired. You know, so my friend was in there and said, quick, turn it off. We turned the machine off and then restarted it. And we were just praying that it would come up again. And it hadn't had time to reformat the hard drive. So we lucked out. But anyway.
And it really is. People don't appreciate that now, I think. But all it took was one wrong command in DOS, and you could do a ton of damage.
Yeah. Really awful. So when the Egyptians would come to Berkeley to see the progress of the study, they would always have a visit. They came three or four times while I was there. They would always come to my little computer lab, I would display the results of these color contour drawings, and they would be very excited about that. But there was one thing that really bugged Seed, is that as it rendered the drawing, it would start from the top and go down to draw the dam and all the, like, whether the pore pressures, what they were, and so forth. And he tried to get me to change it, but it was so intertwined throughout the code that I couldn't do it. So one day the Egyptians came over and started drawing it from the top down. He says, well, you know, here at Berkeley, we're a little unusual. We do things differently than most people around the world. So here at Berkeley, we build our dams from the top down. That's just what we do. So he tried to cover for our weakness in that conversation.
That is great. And those were amazing stories. And for our viewers, rest assured that I know Kyle is going to have even more when he gives the Seed lecture in Vancouver. You're going to want to be there for that. And of course, we would love to see all of you there. So Kyle, you made it through the entire interview. You did a great job. And this Woo-hoo! Was a lot of fun. We got through so many topics. Somebody can go find your favorite sandwich. They know a little bit more about blast liquefaction. They're looking forward to the Seed lecture and a lot more. So for all of our viewers out there, if you liked what you saw, and you likely you did because you're here at the end, you should click like, subscribe, and get notifications. And we will, of course, let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. So Kyle, thank you for doing this.
Thanks for asking me on. It's a privilege.
I hope it was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. I always have a lot of fun at these.
You're a fun guy.
Thank you. And for our viewers, we will see you next week with a brand new episode of Director's Cut.